President, and congratulations on the celebration of our 200 years church anniversary. Indeed, we are not perfect, but we are a great family because we serve a loving and amazing God. Amen.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
For the pioneer members of this church and for those whom has added our church family over the years, may we continue on serving the Lord, strengthening the members and sharing the good news to the seniors. I pray for the good news and for the good grace, wisdom and blessing on our church family as we celebrate God's goodness and faithfulness to us. Again, happy 200 years church anniversary. Let us pray. Loving Father, thank you for those who have not forgotten me in times of loneliness and trouble. Help me to be a better friend and neighbor to those around me. I lift my voice in praise to you that you have encouraged the people who went before me and that I can trust you. Never to leave me, Lord, alone. Send unto us today thy Holy Spirit to give us knowledge and wisdom to understand thy word. Blessed us according to thy will. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Brothers and sisters, Paul stood in the middle of the Areopagus, which was the open forum for philosophical debate. Areopagus was an ancient port in Athens. It was a matter of legal debate and served as an arena for all judicial matters. It was also a place where people could come and worship their gods. It served as a makeshift temple for people to practice their religious sentiments. It could be also known as a legal court, temple, and school of learning. Therefore, Athens was the religion and intellectual center of the Greco-Roman world. According to our text, Paul was in the middle of the Areopagus and say, "People of Athens, I perceive that in every way you are very religious, that on one of your altar is written to the unknown God, to the unknown God. Who is this unknown God? Worshipped by the Athenians, no adequate explanation heard from. What makes the people this idol ascribe to the unknown God? What was clear was more of safety precaution. Because the Athenians were thought to have done this because of fear of the gods during that time. The idols or gods were above of the people according to the Athenians' belief that if they were offended or most less ignored, their idols or their gods would send down their wrath. Paul, in his sermon, tried to change the Athenian concept of worshiping the unknown God. Paul wants to re-educate the people and realign their worship to the true God. Paul took the opportunity to introduce the real God to them by saying, and I quote, "Therefore, the one whom you worship without knowing, him I proclaim to you, God whom in the world and everything in it, since he is the Lord of heaven and earth, does not dwell in temples made with hands." Who this God is? He is the one who made heaven and earth and all is in it. In Isaiah chapter 42, verse 5, it says, and I quote, "Thus said the Lord God who created the heaven and stretched them out, who spread out the earth and what comes from it, who gives breath to the people and spirit to those who in it." Paul in his sermon tried to describe God in many ways. God is the substance of all human virtues. He is all powerful, all knowing and present everywhere. This God is the Father of all creation. He is all powerful and sustains the universe. He exists outside the universe, yet he is present throughout the universe. He exists in nature, but he is not nature nor bound by the law of nature. Therefore, he is the source of all life and everything that is. Now, we can also describe God by contrasting him with our human limitation. For example, we are mortal, but God is immortal. We are fallible, but God is infallible. God is a spirit, eternal and everlasting. God has no beginning or end. He is a person who is totally self-aware. God is the essence of love, and he is loving. He is also righteous judge, totally fair and just. The character of the unknown God whom Paul wants to introduce to the Athenians is the creator God, the sustainer God, the maintainer of life, the supernatural helper who helps people keep his commandments. After Jesus ascended in heaven, he sent the promised helper, the Holy Spirit. If we accepted Jesus Christ into our lives, we have the Spirit of truth living inside us. We have a supernatural helper in life who can give us the power to be victorious. The Athenians does not have the spirit of truth. That's why they can be easily deceived. They have no spiritual discernment. But today, brother and sister, we are lucky because we have a supernatural compass within us, the Holy Spirit, to keep us on course. In verse 13, our text, It says, truly, this time of ignorance, God overlooked. But now, God commands all men everywhere to repent. All should repent. This requires three things. First, renunciation and reversal of old ways, chosen and formed under the kingdom of heaven. Second, submission to God with a teachable spirit. Third, continual growing in the fruit of the Holy Spirit. Brothers and sisters, there is no birth in the kingdom of God without hearing the call to renounce one's sin and then turning from sin toward Christ the Savior. There is no growth without obedience to Jesus' command and responsiveness as disciple of Jesus, yielding to the teaching of God's word. And there is no lifelong increase of growth without willingness to accept the Holy Spirit correction in guidance. God uses people today like Paul in Athens to confront them and others with inescapable decision of embracing or rejecting his truth. Every person who hears the gospel message is given the opportunity to share the good news. Why? Because God has appointed a day on which he will judge the world in righteousness by whom he has ordained. Has given assurance to all by rising Jesus from the dead. Brother and sister, God expects a day of judgments in the future. But bear in mind that we could not determine the exact date of this judgment day. As mentioned in chapter 9 of Psalms, verse 8, he judges the world with righteousness. He judges the people with uprightness. What we know is that God has already determined a specific times in which God will judge. If you believe it, go share the good news and set a time to educate the ignorance, to love the unlovable, to reach the unreachable, to welcome the outcast, and to help the downcast so that they might be in the kingdom of God. Last May 21, the whole world bothered by the judgment day. Are you aware of that? Today, another warning made as the Washington Post Chronicles posted yesterday that the world will still end but on October 10. This is according to the to Harold Camping, the author. And I want to read the article wrote by Elizabeth Tennedy, the editor of the Washington Post. And I'd like to show you the portion of his article. War will still end, but on October 21. You have been warned, Radio Evangelist Harold Campaign said in a special radio broadcast Monday night that his predicted May 21 rapture was an invisible judgment day that he has come to understand as a spiritual rather than physical event. We had all our dates correct, Camping insisted, clarifying that he now understands that Christ, May 21, arrival was a spiritual coming, ushering in the last 5 months before the final judgment and destruction. Camping walked listeners through his numerical timeline, insisting his teaching has not changed and that the world will still end October 21. It won't not be spiritual on October 21, Camping said, adding the world is going to be destroyed altogether, but it will be very big. His former assertion was that a faithful 3% would be physically pulled into heaven by God to the rapture on May 21, to be followed by a 5-month period of great suffering known as the tribulation, ending finally October 21. On Monday, Camping speculated that perhaps a merciful God decided to spare humanity for 5 months of hell on earth. This article reminds three things. It testified that there is true God, as St. Paul proclaimed in the middle of the Areopagus. And secondly, it reminds us to be always ready so that if Mr. Harold Camping is right, we're ready to die. Third, it also testifies that Antichrist are arising as sign of the second coming of Jesus Christ. Remember, brother and sister, nobody knows for sure when Jesus Christ is going to return. And it is foolish to make speculation about the date of his coming. But this present world system is falling apart before our very eyes. All the things that the people used to put their trust in, it seems to be collapsing, like what happened in Japan, like what Osama bin Laden trying to establish, are proof that all system built by human element will not last long. Government come and go, and the world is still in chaos. Our hope and confidence must be in Jesus Christ alone, the only God, because he is the only God certain in this uncertain world. This God that the Athenians have been worshipping ignorantly is in fact the creator of the world in all his being. But not only He the creator. But he does not need of everything, nor he serves like other gods. This God has predestined where men ought to live and has set their time on this earth. The purpose is that men will seek God in communion with Him. The message that Paul preached to those on the Areopagus is the message that echoes throughout the ages today. Will you believe or continue to deny the good news? Brother and sister, the choice is yours. Amen.
Amen.